I've been spending a good deal of time lately reflecting on my father's sorrow over Israel and all who have chosen to go their own way and reject him. He has let me experience some of his sorrow on a small scale to help give me understanding. I say on a small scale because I do not think that I could handle any more, because it is heart-wrenching that his creation has rejected him when all he wanted to do is build a family, an incredible family made up of love. He has been showing me a little bit of the effort that he has had to go through just to build the first fruits of his family. He gave us his instructions through his servants, the prophets, but most of his chosen people have rejected those instructions over and over again. This causes him much sorrow and much grief. We read his son telling us in Matthew 23, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you that kill the prophets and stone them which are sent to you, how often would I have gathered your children together, even as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, under her protection, and you would not." In order to understand why us not hearkening to his instructions causes both Yeshua and his father so much hurt, you have to seek to understand why he gave us the instructions in the first place. They were given to us to mold and fashion us in his image, so when we reject them, we are rejecting his offer to become his family. This is so sad, but he had to make us with free will to accomplish what he is building, so he chose to receive the suffering that we have placed upon his heart in order to build his family. He had to subject himself to this hurt because he knew that most would reject him, yet he wanted to build a family with his character, and there was no other way. In order for him to fashion his character in our inward parts, it had to be a choice on our part. We had to choose to want him, which means that we could also choose to reject him, and this has caused him and his son much sorrow indeed. Israel continued to choose to reject his offer by perverting it to make him and his son in their image. Thus they have showed contempt for them over and over again. His character is total righteousness and love, selfless but also just. It is almighty, but it is also abounding in mercy, and his mercy and his love have been trampled underfoot, just as his son's shed blood has been trampled underfoot by so many. In creating us, his design was perfection in every detail. He knew that in order for us to experience joy and happiness, that we must also know what the opposite of it is. He gave us emotions because he has emotions. Our emotions drive our actions either to good or to evil, but he does not want us to decide what is good for evil for ourselves. He wants us to follow his blueprint into his righteousness. He must be our potter if we are to be made in his image. So choosing to go our own way makes him sad because he knows that our choice is to go our own way is against us and against why he gave us life. His path leads to true and pure relationships. He knows that in order to know how to love, we must also know that what hurt and sorrow is, because he wants us to choose to love one another and to choose to love him and to choose to purge out that which hurts one another. In his perfection, he knows that happiness and love and peace and all good emotions cannot be fully realized alone. Therefore, he is all about relationships with him and with one another. This whole thing here is about building a family and having right relationships, loving one another and being selfless. He is also just, as I said. It takes our acquiring his justice, his righteousness from within to learn to desire to purge out that which destroys relationships, both relationships with him and with his son and with one another. He desires to write his character in our inward essence so that we can have a perfect relationship with him and with one another for eternity. How incredible it's going to be in that family and to have all that is contrary to his will purged out. He gave us life for this purpose, but most have rejected his plan to reproduce his character in us. He gave us life so that we could become his family and take on his character. As I said, in order for this to be fully a part of our very essence, it had to be a choice to be taught by him and molded by him to receive it. He experiences hurt and sorrow when he is rejected, just as we experience hurt and sorrow when we are rejected. He experiences the feeling of being loved when he is loved, just as we do when we are loved. He experiences anger when he is wronged, just as we do when we are wronged. If you can seek to understand this, then maybe you can see just how much hurt and sorrow and grief that you have caused him by rejecting him, rejecting his path. Can you imagine being able to look in the hearts and minds of every man or woman who has ever lived and hold back your fury for all of the injustices that have been done in the world, both in thought and in deed? Yet he had to let these things go on if he was to accomplish what he set out to do. He had to let time go on for as long as it would take to finish his temple, his first fruits, and he knew how long that would take. And oh, how much patience and mercy he has extended to man during this time. Just seek to understand how bad it must have gotten before the flood for him to have destroyed everything but one family. You read in Genesis 6, verse 5, and Yahweh saw that the evil of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it sorrowed Yahweh that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him in his heart. And Yahweh said, I will destroy man whom I have created from off the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping thing, and the fowls of the air, because it sorrows me that I have made them. Understanding what is evil from his perspective will give you some perspective on how much each of us has grieved him by rejecting his path. You stealing, for example. Stealing is evil because it destroys relationships. Stealing can be stealing the time that you should be spending with one another, loving one another. This causes hurt to the other person, just as us choosing to reject the time that he wants us to spend with him causes hurt to him. But there's also another side to this as well. Let's say that your nature is contrary to what is right, and your behavior is such that your spouse does not want to be around you. You are stealing from him or her because your relationship should be enjoyed together. And if your actions are detestable to what is pure and right, you certainly have accountability for causing the other person to not want to spend time with you. This causes hurt for that person. You're the one responsible for that hurt, just as when we do that which is detestable to our Creator, and he cannot stand to be in our presence. And this is hurting him because he not only sees that we are hurting ourselves, but we are also robbing him of the relationship that he wants to have with us. He wants to forgive us so that we can return to him, just as we must forgive one another. Yet that which is wrong and causes the hurt and the separation must stop. This is what repentance is, changing to that which is holy and right and changing to his path. So you see, stealing can be more than just stealing on a physical plane from his perspective. It can be stealing good emotions from him or from one another. Let me give you an example of stealing on an emotional plane from our Creator in regards to his commandments. He set up a weekly appointed time for you to and I to come before him and spend the day with him. Of course, he wants us to spend every waking moment with him, but he made some days mandatory. You are stealing from him by not showing up for his appointment. And you are stealing from yourself because he wants to feed you his character in an increased way on his appointed times. How about adultery? Do you commit adultery with him? The answer is yes, if you have a relationship with the make-believe version of him that is not in spirit and in truth. This is idolatry and whoredom. Do you think this grieves him? Both he and his son said over and over again in several different ways, if you love them, keep his commandments. Not keeping them is confessing to them that you think that he and his servants are liars. Why do they tell us over and over again to keep his commandments and his statutes and ordinances? Because they knew that his commandments were given for us to walk with them. They are a path to walk with them on. If you are not walking in the commandments and the statutes and ordinances, you have rejected his path and are walking with a different God, a make-believe God of your imagination. Does this grieve them? Absolutely. Do you think that things are better or worse today than during the days before the flood? I can guarantee you they're worse. The flood was to be an example of the consequences of are rejecting his path to his righteous character, because obtaining his character was why he created us. The next verse shows us what he delights in verse 8. But Noah found favor in the eyes of Yahweh. Noah was a just man and full of truth in his life, and Noah walked with Elohim. Oh, how our Creator has delighted in those who chose to walk with him on his path. Do those who walk with him on his path still grieve him from time to time when they stumble? Absolutely, but our relationship with him grows as we grow in his likeness, and he delights in us more and more and more, and we delight in him more and more and more. We don't tell him how it is when we stumble. We are broken for sinning against him and causing him hurt. He forgives us because we desire to walk with him as a way of life, so that we can be perfected in his image, and he delights in this, and we delight in one another. When we reach a point of wanting his way of life and his character, no matter what, You're sealed into his family and promised eternal life. This is why we were created, not to continue to cause hurt to one another and cause destruction to what is right and what leads to eternity. The false religion called Christianity claims to have a relationship with him through the shed blood of his son. The problem is they mock the shed blood of his son by rejecting why he shed his blood for them. He shed his blood so that we could be forgiven and his Father's Torah or path could be written in our hearts and in our minds. Since they reject the reason that he died on their behalf, the relationship is with a make-believe Messiah and a make-believe God of their heart's imaginations. They are adulterers and adulteresses. Does this grieve them? Oh, how they long for you to turn to them in spirit and in truth. In my last video, I read a verse from Ezekiel 3, but the house of Israel will not hearken to you because they will not hearken to me, because all of the house of Israel are impudent and hard-hearted. He has sent me to you to plead with you to turn from your ways. I'm talking to the scattered tribes of Israel. Yes, you drifted into captivity by rejecting his words and made him of an image who you wanted him to be. So you are primarily in captivity to the false religion of Christianity today, which is Babylon. Scoff at this if you would like, but it is true. You have continued to be a rebellious house, and you have caused my father, his son, and his saints so much sorrow and grief for so many years. This is why now that the first phase of his family is complete, he is going to bring Babylon destruction. You're going to tear her down. Your false worship to him has been an abomination to him and to his son. If it was not for those few who continued to come to his call and come out of Babylon by returning to him, he would have destroyed you long ago. But now his temple is finished and he is still giving you a chance to repent and to turn to him. But if you are stiff-necked and most of you will not believe him and his servants, just as you have never believed them. Thus saith Yahweh Elohim, I will mock you in the day of your calamity because you have mocked me. But he is pleading with you to come out of Babylon and be not partakers of the wrath of his indignation. Find favor in his eyes by returning to his love that he has poured out to you and turn to his path and walk with him on it. Stop grieving him and causing him so much sorrow and tears. Turn to him and let him deliver you. He is crying out to you to come out of her. In Revelations 18, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great has fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and Elohim has remembered her evil. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works, in the cup which she has filled to her double. Scripture defines that anything that takes you away from his path is false, and therefore it is evil because it leads people to the lake of fire. Christianity has led billions under the writings of Saul of Tarsus to a false Messiah and a make-believe God and to a different path. Thus saith Yahweh Elohim, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, come out of her, my people.